Hello friends, I'm Dr. Sonali Chandra and I welcome you all to our YouTube channel Medicine Decoded. Now in this video today, I bring to you a very, very important clinical situation which we can encounter or we can find ourselves in while taking care of our laboring women, so in our labor rooms, or when we are taking care of recently delivered women in the postpartum care unit. And the situation is postpartum collapse. Now postpartum collapse means hemodynamic instability. So as the name suggests, it is an obstetric emergency. We need to be on our feet to come to an immediate diagnosis if we want to save the life of the woman, right? So therefore, it is very, very important to discuss the various differential diagnoses which are possible causes of postpartum collapse and what do we need to consider while evaluating such women. Now, if I show you the list of the causes here, and these are the obstetric causes, the most common cause of postpartum collapse is postpartum hemorrhage, okay, PPH that we call it. And most of the times it is going to be atonic PPH, that is the uterus fails to contract immediately after delivery. There can be other causes of postpartum hemorrhage also, which are not, atonic PPH, but they are traumatic. So there can be genital tract trauma in the form of, visible bleeding, which is happening, right? And there can be trauma to the vagina, to the cervix, or there can be trauma to the uterus also. There can be ruptured uterus. There can be concealed bleeding. There could be a woman with a case of concealed hemorrhage or bleeding behind the placenta as seen in placental abruption. She went on to deliver and then went on to shock. There could be severe concealed APH, genital hematomas again will have hidden bleeding. And one very particular important thing that we do need to keep in mind is acute uterine inversion as a separate entity for this postpartum collapse also. So I'm going to elaborate on all of these causes one by one. And also do not forget that if a woman is being wheeled with hemodynamic instability into the casualty, do not think that, there cannot be eclampsia. I mean, there could have been a history of convulsions, history of pre-eclampsia. So you need to consider eclampsia as a potential differential diagnosis also, and even keep your mind open to the possibility of pulmonary embolism as well. And apart from these obstetric causes, there can be a number of coincidental medical or surgical causes also. I mean, she could have been maybe a known case of heart disease, or maybe she was a heart disease patient. She was just not aware of it. So you might not find any history pertaining to that. But then she could have been an acute cardiac failure because of an underlying heart disease condition. There could have been anesthetic accidents. Like, let's say, for example, you're operating on a patient, you're doing a cesarean section, everything is going on fine, but suddenly the anesthetist tells you that the woman is having hemodynamic instability, she's going into cardiogenic shock, and then you start thinking about the possibility of anesthetic accidents. There could have been a high spinal block because of that. And reactions to the drugs also sometimes can lead to acute postpartum collapse, particularly the local anesthetic agents when injected in the venous circulation or when they're injected into the systemic circulation. So you need to keep all of these possibilities in mind also. There could be a traumatic pneumothorax, there could be a ruptured aneurysm or a myocardial infarction. So medical surgical causes can also be responsible for postpartum collapse, but most of the times you first consider these acute obstetric emergencies also. Now moving on further, let's have a look at this clinical situation and then we'll go step by step to find out about the differential diagnosis. So there's a 30-year-old woman, she is second gravida para 1 live 1 and she's at 38 weeks of gestation. She delivered a healthy baby boy, no problem there, about 30 minutes back without any complications, right? So it so happens, that many times a woman's delivery in itself, I mean the delivery of the baby, the delivery of the placenta, can be entirely without any complications and then suddenly deterioration immediately postpartum. That can also happen, and that is why there is a need to carefully observe all delivering women till we are assured that everything is fine with them, at least up an hour post delivery of the placenta, that we, what we call as the stage 4 of labor, needs to be followed. Now she's come, she's about 30 minutes back, she delivered without any complications. Now she suddenly becomes breathless, she starts gasping, her pulse becomes hypovolemic, right, at a rate of about 120 per minute, her systolic BP falls to about 80 mmHg and her peripheries are cold. So we know that she is in postpartum collapse, there is hemodynamic instability. How do you approach this woman? Now the approach to diagnosis has to follow certain principles, right? First of all, please remember that simultaneous resuscitation should begin immediately. It should not wait for a diagnosis. So when you are talking about the hemodynamic instability and shock, that has to be managed along the same lines as any shock is managed. So I'm not going to talk about that, but I'm going to talk about the various differential diagnosis. So you need to immediately check for vaginal bleeding, because my first concern is maybe she is bleeding too much, maybe there is postpartum hemorrhage. So I need to immediately check for vaginal bleeding. I need to immediately palpate the fundus. So I need to do a perabdominal examination, and I need to check whether the uterus is contracted or not. I need to examine the vulva, the vagina and the cervix also to rule out if there is any genital tract trauma which is contributing to so much bleeding that she is becoming hemodynamically unstable. Also at the same time, whenever a woman is collapsing, you need to observe for chest pain, cyanosis, features of hypoxia. So that would make you think more in terms of cardiac or a pulmonary pathology there. You should be on the lookout for evidence of deep venous thrombosis as well, because again, you know, pregnancy is a state of hypercoagulability, and you can have visible evidence and clinical evidence of deep venous thrombosis. You can go for the leg examination of the woman. The legs could be swollen and distended and warm and tender. So that would be an evidence of DVT. And then again, in that scenario, if there is a hemodynamic instability, if there is a collapse patient with breathlessness and everything, you start thinking maybe it is now a pulmonary thromboembolism. So you need to keep these principles in mind while evaluating the woman. At the same time, taking a very careful and measured history, a thorough, measured, careful, thorough history, which has to be very quick, because you don't have to waste time with this, all right? So you need to have details of antepartum and intrapartum events, because a lot can be gained by knowing the events of the circumstances around the time of delivery, right? Let's say, for example, she's having a flabby uterus and there's atonicity, she's bleeding a lot, and you need to see what was done at the time of her delivery. Was third stage actively managed or not? Who was conducting the delivery? Was she taken care of? Was she observed or not? So the details of antepartum and intrapartum events is very, very important. Was she a case of concealed abruption or placental abruption, which was in the process of delivery, and then she acutely worsened? You see, so these are the kind of information that you want from your history, right? Now, history of hypertension and convulsions also become important. Now, first of all, there could be a woman who's been wheeled into the emergency in a collapsed state. Maybe there's a history of convulsions behind it, and then you don't waste your time diagnosing why she is in a collapsed state. The other important thing why history of convulsions and hypertension is important, please understand, pre-eclamptic women, eclamptic women, they are hemoconcentrated, you see. They're not hemodiluted like normal pregnant women. So they might not even be able to tolerate the usual amounts of blood loss during delivery. I mean, even 500 ml of blood loss may be too much for them. So they have this inability to tolerate blood loss. Like, for example, I clearly remember a scenario when a woman with pre-eclampsia was delivering, and you know, she went into complete hemodynamic collapse immediately after delivery. However, there was visible bleeding, was not too much. Neither was she having atonic PPH or anything, right? But she couldn't even tolerate that little amount of blood loss, and that's why she collapsed immediately after delivery. So the history of hypertension, convulsion becomes important. History of diabetes becomes important also. I mean, if she is a diabetic woman on insulin or not on insulin and delivering, and you know, again, the details of antepartum and intrapartum events become important. I mean, was she taken care of or not? I mean, did she deliver in your hospital, in your setting, or has she come from outside, delivered at a peripheral healthcare centers? These are all relevant information, because she could be diabetic ketoacidosis, or she could simply be hypoglycemic. So thus, history is very, very important. History of difficult or prolonged labor. Was instrument delivery done? Because that would make you suspect the possibility of genital tract trauma or uterine rupture, maybe as a complication arising from difficult or prolonged labor or instrumental delivery. And also take history of heart disease or respiratory disease from the relatives nearby. and of course any past papers, any past information about her medical status needs to be looked into. Now moving on further, let's have a look at the differential diagnosis one by one. So if have a woman of postpartum collapse, I said first focus on vaginal bleeding. So if the vaginal bleeding is excessive and the uterus is relaxed, described as a flabby uterus, my diagnosis becomes certain, right? So on per abdominal examination, you palpate the fundus and you realize that the uterus is relaxed and flabby. Your diagnosis is atonic PPH, and you start the resuscitation and giving uterotonic drugs for management of the woman. So you manage atonic PPH, right? If there is vaginal bleeding, a lot of vaginal bleeding, but the uterus is contracted, it is not flabby, right? But still there is vaginal bleeding, you start thinking that obviously there might be a genital tract trauma, right? And therefore you need to carefully examine her local examination. You need to look at her vulva to see if there's any injury there. You need to examine the vagina for tears or lacerations. You need to examine the cervix for tears or lacerations. So thorough examination needs to be done. Having said that, there can be situations where a woman is having both atonic and genital tract trauma as contributing to her bleeding. I mean, these two can coexist. So while you're managing the atonic PPH, you get the uterus to contract, and even then if the bleeding is not improving, you start thinking about genital tract trauma alongside. So yes, of course, you need to examine the cervix, vagina and the vulva thoroughly in any woman who is having a lot of vaginal bleeding immediately after delivery. There can be situations, you know, when you know you delivered the woman, there was an episiotomy or there was a tear on the vulva and the vagina, which you stitched, took care of that, and then you went around doing other things in the labor room, and then you come back and realize the woman is in postpartum collapse, and you wonder, I did everything, but there is a possibility that maybe there was, you know, some difficult delivery or instrumental delivery, and careful examination of the vagina and the cervix was not done when the episiotomy was stitched, and therefore maybe there are some tears which are left behind, or the apex of the episiotomy was not stitched properly and therefore there is bleeding from that side. So there are many situations which can lead to this acute bleeding in the form of postpartum hemorrhage. You need to keep these points in mind. Therefore, very important to consider the circumstances around the delivery. Okay, now moving on further, if you have postpartum collapse and the shock is out of proportion to the visible bleeding, I mean bleeding from the vagina is not too much, but her hemodynamic instability is out of proportion, she is in shock, and look for if there is any history of a sharp lower abdominal pain immediately before her collapse. Initially there is going to be bradycardia, and yes, and later on there might be tachycardia as well when blood loss starts happening. Per abdomen, the fundus is not palpable. I told you it is very, very important to look at the per abdominal examination as well. So once your fundus is not palpable on per abdominal examination, what do you suspect? You suspect that it is a uterine inversion, right? So look at this. This is the normal uterus. The fundus here is in its right location. But here you can see that the fundus has dipped down, right? So this is what we call as uterine inversion. Again, taking a careful, thorough history around the circumstances around delivery, because you'd see that the most common reason why uterine inversion occurs is actually mismanagement of third stage of labor. So who was conducting the delivery? Was he trained in conducting the delivery? Okay. Did he have any difficulty in delivering the placenta? Because most of the times this uterine inversion is going to happen while delivering the placenta. Was he following controlled cord traction as a method to deliver the placenta or not? Was he having difficulty? Did he apply too much traction? Did he pull on the umbilical cord to deliver the placenta while the uterus was relaxed? So all of these things make up a thorough history around the circumstances around delivery, and then you start suspecting that this is uterine inversion. Okay, So keep this in mind. Sometimes, you know, in this particular case, you can see that the fundus here has inverted through the cervix, is being palpated in the vagina. In extremes of cases, the entire fundus, you know, could come way out of, entire complete inversion can happen, and you can palpate or you can even see a reddish boggy mass at the introitus. I mean, that would be complete inversion if this entire fundus has come all the way out through the introitus. And then the clinical situation becomes fairly much evident just on examination itself. But focus on this, whether the fundus is palpable perabdominally or not. And then you think about uterine inversion. Right? So when you have hemodynamic instability, you talk about bleeding. If there is bleeding, you start thinking in terms of postpartum hemorrhage, maybe a tonic, maybe traumatic. If the bleeding is out of, the shock is out of proportion of visible bleeding, fundus is not palpable per abdomen, you start thinking about uterine inversion. Okay, and keep the circumstances around delivery in mind as well. Now, I told you here that there is bradycardia initially. So you can see here what happens is when the fundus inverts, okay, when the fundus inverts and the uterus inverts, the round ligament, the fallopian tube, the ovarian ligament, ovaries, they are pulled into this crater that is created once the fundus inverts. And that puts you know, a neurogenic element to the shock, right? The nerves which are here in the peritoneal lining, they are pulled and stretched, and therefore there is initially a neurogenic component to the shock, therefore bradycardia initially. But later on, what will happen is that this uterus, which is in an abnormal situation, inverted, will not also be able to contract properly. Eventually hemorrhagic shock will set in. Now, moving on further, let's have a look at another differential diagnosis. If there is postpartum collapse and you realize that the uterus is contracted, it is not atonic PPH, it is not uterine inversion, you have able to palpate the fundus, and you realize that the bleeding is coming out of the cervical os. So you can see here, there's nothing in the vagina, cervix, anywhere, no injury left there unattended to, but you realize that the bleeding is coming out from the os. Then you start thinking about maybe there is a uterine tear, right? Maybe there is a uterus rupture, and therefore you need to have a look at the signs and symptoms of hemoperitoneum as well. Signs and symptoms hemoperitoneum as well. So maybe the bleeding happened so much that it collected inside the peritoneal cavity, right? So keep that in mind. Also, again, circumstances around delivery. Now, why would a uterus rupture happen? A uterus rupture or a uterus tear will happen under peculiar circumstances. Like, again, history of difficult delivery. History of difficult delivery, traumatic delivery, instrumental delivery. Was she a grand multiparous woman? Okay, grand multiparous woman, right? Was she having a delivery which was conducted at home? You know, untrained individuals were conducting the delivery at home. So that also should that also should raise the possibility and make you consider uterine rupture as the diagnosis. Was she having history of a vaginal birth after a cesarean, which makes a uterus rupture a possible complication? So you need to consider all of these factors and be aware of uterine rupture as the possible cause of postpartum collapse as well. Okay, now moving on further, let's consider a situation where you have postpartum collapse, right? The visible bleeding is within normal limits, so there is there's no excessive blood loss coming from the vagina. However, there could have been a history of inability to pass urine. I mean, I remember a case where a woman was, brought into the casualty in a postpartum collapse situation. And when we were asking the history about the circumstances around the delivery, how did she collapse? What happens? So they said that she went to pass urine and she went for a couple of times and she was unable to pass urine. And ultimately what happened was that one final attempt, she went to pass urine and then she collapsed in the toilet itself. So this kind of a history where there has been a history of inability to pass urine. We did a per-abdominal examination. We found that the bladder is distended. Now you can find the bladder distended, of course, if there has been inability to pass urine. So all the urine gets collected. So on per-abdomen, you can have a distended bladder. Sometimes you might have a empty bladder if the woman has gone into hypovolemic shock. So keep that in mind. This can or cannot be there. The bladder might not be distended if the woman is in hypovolemic shock contributing to acute renal failure. Then the bladder won't be distended. But yes, do keep this history in mind. And then you think about genital hematomas, right? I mean, do not skip the local examination of the woman while you are taking care of postpartum collapse patients, because if there is a vulval hematoma, okay, then it is going to be visible on local examination, right? Similarly, there could have been a case that a woman has been referred from the peripheral healthcare facility. Somebody has delivered the woman outside. There was an episiotomy. They stitched the episiotomy. You can see the epi repaired from the outside. But on the inside, you'll realize that the apex of the episiotomy was not included while suturing. And now there has become a hematoma on the episiotomy side. So it is a vaginal hematoma. So please do not skip the vaginal examination part at all. In postpartum collapse patients, so you can have a hematoma here in the vagina, anywhere, right? So you will do a per-vaginal examination and you can clearly feel this bulge. It can be on the lateral wall, anterior wall, posterior wall, anywhere, right? So there can be a hematoma there as well. So keep in mind the possibility of genital hematoma. Okay, so they can be vulval or vaginal hematomas. And again, since all the bleeding is being collected inside these hematoma, the visible bleeding is going to be within normal limits. However, this vulval hematoma, this vaginal hematoma, if it is going to compress on the urethra in the front, it can lead to inability to pass urine also. So you can have genital hematomas as a potential cause of postpartum collapse as well. Now, moving on, let's have another situation. We have a woman with postpartum collapse. The visible bleeding is within normal limits, right? There is no hematoma, okay? The vulva, vagina, and the cervix, they're all normal, nothing here. You did a local examination, vulva fine, no hematoma there. You did a per-vaginal examination, everything fine, no hematoma there. You explored the cervix also. So you do a speculum examination and you look at the cervix, nothing, no tear there anywhere, everything normal. And a per-abdominal examination, you find that the uterus is contracted and is slightly deviated to one side. That gives you a clue. That gives you a clue that maybe there is a hematoma here, right? So this would be a broad ligament hematoma. Again, the circumstances around the delivery will give you a clue, right? It will happen under the setting of a difficult delivery. And you know, practices like giving, you know, fundal pressure to conduct delivery, which should entirely be discouraged. Okay, So practices like that. So that is why, you know, delivery by untrained professionals, such kind of history, home delivery might be there, or maybe she was a case of previous cesarean section and, you know, delivered at home, unsupervised. You know, these are the kind of history that you're going to consider if there's a broad ligament hematoma. Instrumental delivery, vacuum and forceps applied when, you know, somebody who's much junior, who's untrained, who attempted that, and, you know, the criteria for instrumentation was not fulfilled. High instrument application was done when the head was still high. So you need to, you know, be cautious about the circumstances around the delivery, which will help you make to come at the right diagnosis immediately. So clues will be hidden under the circumstances around the delivery most of the times, and these are the clues which you should not miss to arrive at a immediate diagnosis. And of course, if you're suspecting this situation, you can, you know, alongside the resuscitation, you can do an urgent blood bedside ultrasound also to help you arrive at this diagnosis. Now, moving on further, let's have a look at this situation. Now, this postpartum collapse, right, and along with collapse, along with hemodynamic instability, there is breathlessness. Okay, you're seeing that the woman is becoming hypoxic. You measure her PO2, you measure her oxygen saturation, it is less. She may be having visible cyanosis. She's also having signs and symptoms of right heart failure. She's having, crepitations in the chest. She's having signs and symptoms of deep venous thrombosis also. Then you think, yeah, this is pulmonary embolism. Then you think there is pulmonary embolism. Right? So what is embolism? Embolism is any solid, liquid, or even gas. Right, molecules or particles of solid, liquid, or gas which gain access to the systemic circulation and cause blockage and consequences because of that. So you can have this pulmonary embolism because of thrombus, which is called as thromboembolism. Likewise, you have air embolism also, right? So you can have pulmonary thromboembolism. So that's why if there are signs and symptoms of deep venous thrombosis, then pulmonary thromboembolism is the most likely diagnosis. And another situation unique to obstetrics causing pulmonary embolism is amniotic fluid embolism, right? Now, amniotic fluid embolism is a rare and life-threatening condition. Unfortunately, it cannot be predicted as to who are the women who are going to, have amniotic fluid embolism. Risk factors have been identified, but they're very variable. Most of the times it happens in entirely situations where you are not even having any high risk factors. So amniotic fluid embolism is a diagnosis of exclusion. Once you have ruled out the more common possibilities of postpartum collapse and you find nothing, I mean, then as a diagnosis of exclusion, clinical diagnosis of exclusion, you think maybe it is amniotic fluid embolism as well, be it very life-threatening. However, the incidence of amniotic fluid embolism is about 2 to 3 per 100,000 deliveries. So it's rare, but when it does happen, it is a life-threatening situation. So what do we realize we see in pulmonary embolism of any kind? I mean, be it a thrombus which is causing pulmonary thromboembolism, or is it amniotic fluid particles which are causing amniotic fluid embolism? The chest pathology is going to be because of the process of embolism. So what happens is that there is acute pulmonary vascular obstruction, depending upon how much of the pulmonary vasculature is involved in the obstruction process. So when 60 to 70% of the vasculature is involved, we start getting features of pulmonary hypertension. So there is blockage here in the pulmonary vascular tree, and that is causing increased pressure in the pulmonary arterial system. So that is pulmonary hypertension, and that is going to have, because of this high pressure in the pulmonary artery system, what is going to happen is the right side of the heart is going to fail first, right? So you're going to have right-sided heart failure first, eventually left ventricular failure will set in, and then, you know, hypotension and shock, cardiogenic shock features are going to develop. Now, moving on further, what happens with this acute pulmonary obstruction? Okay, what happens with pulmonary embolism? Please remember, whenever there is embolism or thrombosis blocking the circulation, you realize that there is infarction. Now, in the lungs, on the other hand, infarction is not that common, you see, because the lung tissue is also supplied by bronchial arteries. But the manifestations of pulmonary embolism happen because what happens is that there is a ventilation and perfusion mismatch. Okay, that is the key that is happening. You see, the alveoli, the air we breathe enters the alveoli. Look at the capillaries. Now there is blockage here, embolism here, embolism here, embolism here, blockage here. So now these alveoli, they are ventilated, but they are not perfused. And that is why there is this immediate manifestation of hypoxia, breathlessness, because of ventilation and perfusion mismatch. Okay, once the hypoxia is so severe and so prolonged, it can even end up with the brain becoming hypoxic, and ultimately there can be convulsions and coma. So what are the features that will happen with pulmonary embolism? You'll have evidence of breathlessness, hypoxia, cyanosis. You can have evidence of ARDS, acute respiratory distress syndrome, and eventually maybe convulsions and coma as well. So this becomes an immediate life-threatening condition. Okay, whether the embolism, pulmonary embolism, is happening because of thromboembolism or amniotic fluid embolism, this ventilation perfusion mismatch is going to happen. And then a peculiarity which is seen with amniotic fluid embolism, what happens is that there is tissue factor in the amniotic fluid. There is tissue factor in the amniotic fluid, which will also leak out into the systemic circulation. Okay, so now when along with amniotic fluid tissue factor goes into the systemic circulation, it reaches the lung field also, right? And therefore what happens is that this tissue factor, it starts to activate the coagulation cascade. I mean, tissue factor is the factor that we know is going to activate the blood coagulation system, blood coagulation cascade, and then it is going to be widespread, right? Widespread. So in the entire systemic circulation, there are going to be microthrombi, small thrombi in the entire circulation. You can see here, these are the RBCs which are engulfed in the thrombosis. There are the platelets and the WBCs which are engulfed in the thrombosis. So the platelets and the clotting factors, they are all consumed because of widespread coagulation, which we call as disseminated intravascular coagulation. And ultimately what will happen is that you'll have a consumptive coagulopathy. The platelets are consumed, the coagulation factors are consumed. That's why it is called as consumptive coagulopathy. And then this woman is going to bleed from every side. Then she's going to have postpartum hemorrhage also. Now that is happening because of DIC, that is a coagulopathy, right? So she is going to bleed, spontaneous bleed from not only from the uterus but also from other sites as well. So what will we see? We will see that the fibrinogen levels are going to be consumed, so they're going to decrease. The fibrin degradation products, which are a reflection of the underlying thrombosis, they are going to increase. Platelets are going to be consumed, so there's going to be thrombocytopenia. If you test the coagulation profile, they will have prolonged PT and APTT because of the consumption of the clotting factors, right? So ultimately DIC is going to set in, right, in a patient with amniotic fluid embolism. And once the woman goes into this consumptive coagulopathy like state, DIC like state, that is the second stage of amniotic fluid embolism. From this second stage, the mortality rate is very high, right? So if we act fast and we prevent this consumptive coagulopathy to happen, then the survival is much better. But once the second stage of DIC sets in, then the survival becomes becomes difficult, and the mortality rate increases much, much more. All right. So keep these differential diagnoses in mind while evaluating postpartum collapse patients. Like, for example, if you consider this scenario again, now I'll come back to the scenario we discussed in the beginning. A 30-year-old woman, G2P1 L1, 38 weeks of gestation, delivered a healthy baby about 30 minutes back without any complications. Now, see, 30 minutes is a clue that has been given to you. That means her situation deteriorated very, very rapidly. She suddenly becomes breathless and starts gasping. So her primary symptom was that of breathlessness, and her pulse became hypovolemic at a rate of 120 per minute. Systolic BP fell to 80 mmHg. So this is acute hemodynamic instability. Her peripheries are cold. The placenta delivered complete. There is no excessive vaginal bleeding. Vaginal examination is normal. What is the most probable diagnosis? So I told you that you have to consider the circumstances around the delivery. Also focus on whether there is visible bleeding. Have a look at the per abdomen examination also. In this question, they're not given a per abdominal examination, but let's say the per abdominal examination says that the uterus is, let's say, contracted. Okay, let's say it is contracted. So now what is your diagnosis? Is it PPH, uterine inversion, DIC or amniotic fluid embolism? What are you considering? See, in PPH, visible bleeding should be there. Okay, in genital tract trauma, visible bleeding would be within normal limits, but at least you will find some evidence of trauma on examination. Maybe you will find hematoma. It is not there. You are excluding everything else. You are excluding uterine inversion because those circumstances around delivery had not been mentioned. You are excluding uterine inversion because, of course, in uterine inversion, they would have given you a clinical situation where the fundus should not be palpable per abdominally. So I will not pick uterine inversion as the answer. Moreover, in acute uterine inversion, there is no reason why immediately breathlessness should be there. Now, what about DIC? Now, DIC is going to happen, let's say, under circumstances where she is a known case of concealed abruption. Right, and then it has progressed over the conductance of delivery, over the timing of delivery, it has progressed to DIC. That could be one possibility, I agree. But here, no such history regarding those conditions or circumstances around delivery have been mentioned in this question. So, making DIC slightly unlikely. Moreover, you will say that this is amniotic fluid embolism leading to DIC, then DIC happens later as the second phase of amniotic fluid embolism. Moreover, if she is having DIC, she will have vaginal bleeding as well. So there's no excessive vaginal bleeding as of now. So DIC also unlikely. However, amniotic fluid embolism, the timing, the symptoms of breathlessness to be happening first, and that sudden deterioration, right, that makes amniotic fluid embolism more likely. And please remember, amniotic fluid embolism is a diagnosis of exclusion, clinical diagnosis of exclusion. So that's why I ruled out all the other causes first before I arrived at amniotic fluid embolism, right? So it has been seen that amniotic fluid embolism can happen anytime during delivery. It's not necessary that it is going to happen postpartum only. It can happen anytime during delivery, but most of the cases are seen around labor, okay, and within 30 minutes of delivery. That is the crucial time. That's why I said the timing was crucial here in making me arrive at the diagnosis of amniotic fluid embolism. What is my management going to be? My management is going to be immediate resuscitation, right? So I'm going to focus on managing her shock. She will need ionotropic support. She will need, ionotropes for the cardiogenic element of the shock. She will need ICU care. I will need to put in a central line because, you know, and now I'm going to manage her like any medical case of embolism, also focusing on correction of the DIC at the same time. So now the management will become multidisciplinary. Anesthetists and physicians are going to also come and care for this woman. So you need to arrive at the diagnosis quickly and need to institute ICU care immediately for the woman to survive, right? Also, a thorough chest and respiratory examination, cardiovascular examination needs to be performed. You need to rule out before coming to the the diagnosis of amniotic fluid embolism, you also need to rule out the possibility of maybe an acute cardiac event that led to this possibility. So the best possibility would be that somebody who's specialist in this field, like a physician reference, should be immediately sought for, so that a careful examination of the heart and lungs can also be attempted. It will all begin with clinical examination, and then depending upon whether we are suspecting a cardiac or a respiratory pathology, further investigations would be ordered. But then immediate institution of ICU care is the key here. And what are the investigations that you can send from the labor room itself at your level? Okay, so what are the investigations that you will send in any patient of postpartum collapse, and also in my particular patient of postpartum collapse? Blood grouping and cross matching, right, immediately needs to be instituted, because you will probably need to give her, if she's having PPH, you'll need to give her packed cell transfusion. If she's into DIC, you'll need to correct that. You'll need to give her fresh frozen plasma, maybe cryoprecipitates. So you need to have blood grouping and cross matching ready. You need to go for a complete blood count. You need to see her HB. You need to see her hematocrit. You need to see her platelet count. She's hypoxic. Maybe she is cyanosis, she is breathless, she is gasping. You need to check her arterial blood gas values also. So you need to send for an ABG, because she'll need correction for acidosis as well. Serum electrolytes you need to send for immediately, right? Coagulation profile screen you need to send for immediately. You need to send for the renal function tests, right? Liver function tests can be done if you are suspecting, you know, a cause, like you are suspecting eclampsia or preeclampsia, then you can go for liver function tests as well. If you're suspecting HELLP syndrome, then you can go for liver function test as well. But this renal function test should definitely be performed in any patient who are having postpartum collapse. And do not forget a very simple blood sugar estimation. Sometimes this is skipped while ordering the test. Do not forget that. It is very simple. I mean, of course, then could be a history of diabetes, could not be a history of diabetes, but that doesn't mean that she could not be hypoglycemic, or she might not be in diabetic ketoacidosis. So there could be cases where you're seeing such patients in the postpartum collapse state for the first time, and the history might not be very clear. Maybe she's not had any antenatal care in the past, so that makes it all the more difficult to arrive at the diagnosis, because then you don't know what you're trying to find. So it is better to set a baseline set, or better to send a baseline set of investigations to help you come at the right diagnosis. And further investigations for the heart and lung, they are performed at a later point in time as and when required. So I hope that you found this session useful. This is very, very important that you should know the differential diagnosis of postpartum collapse. Questions can be framed for your MBBS, for your postgrad entrance examination from this topic. So keep the differential diagnosis in mind, which is very, very important. And you go about reading the question or analyzing the patient for that matter in a step-by-step sequential manner, considering what are the possible things that you are going to look for, because these are the important differential diagnosis that you are considering. Do not forget, read these circumstances around the delivery. Maybe you're reading a question, maybe you're seeing a patient. Do not forget to analyze the circumstances around delivery. They can give you very vital and crucial information as well. Thank you so much, and I'll see you very soon with the next video.